They're going to basically do this in a conversational context. My first question I'm going to ask is the very same question I asked Hans Werner Sinn, which is, God has given me on a piece of paper that there is not going to be one but two euros, and that that is coming, and I would like, and having punished John by introducing him second, I'll punish him further by making him go first. God asserts this. When do you think it would happen, and how painful do you think it would be? John, and then Larry.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. Thanks, Larry, for coming. And I wanted to say a word in honor of John Chauvin and the work he's done at SIEPR. And it's an honor to be a part of this program for his the final SIEPR Summit with John as the director of SIEPR. I'd just like to make one correction I think is non-trivial. It certainly is the conventional wisdom that the global financial crisis began in September 2008. I think it began quite a bit before then. Everyone can have their own dating. For me, it was August 2007 when the flag dropped on the crisis. Frankly, when BNP Paribas closed its funds to withdrawals from its investors. I said, this is really, really serious. And one of the lessons was how long it took for the response, the official response, to gather the force that was necessary to begin to be effective. And I think we should contemplate that. And certainly Larry's speech here in March 2008 was a warning, but we should have seen it coming sooner. Now, to the euro. One thing I think it's important to keep in mind when you ask what was the underlying reason for the adoption of the euro. A lot of folks say, well, it was a political project. Say, well, of course it had political aspects. But if it didn't make economic and financial sense, it wasn't going to be sustained. And the most powerful argument in favor of the single currency was that Europe had to have a single market to thrive as in the modern global economy. And that to sustain a single market, you needed a single currency. And that, I think you need to think about an exit or a division or some new change in that context. In other words, if you started to devolve the single currency in some way, could you sustain the single market that is still incomplete, among other things, in financial terms, but not just in financial terms? And to my mind, that explains the tenacity of the European authorities in trying to maintain the current structure, among other things, but most important, the fear that if some started to go, others would go, and actions would be taken that would unravel the single market that would be extremely difficult to put back together. So I would say, your question was a kind of a loaded one, there's gonna be 2 euros, and when will it happen? I have a hard time accepting that premise, that you could organize something like that within the context of the single market. You could survive, I suspect you could survive an exit of one of the smaller members if circumstances were right, but even that would entail some risks.
Larry?
Let me first say how glad I am to be here and to say that as I look around the world and ask why in the fullness of it all the United States has, with all our problems, had relatively good economic policy over the last two generations. It is in no small part because of gatherings like this one and institutions like SIEPR that bring together the worlds of thought and action for their mutual benefit. And the close relationship between economic research and economic policy, which is a closer relationship in the United States than in many other countries, is, I think, an important source of strength for us. And let me join John Lipsky, and I suspect everyone else who's going to speak here, in saluting the remarkable job of academic entrepreneurship that John Chauvin has done with respect to SIEPR. and to note also that it is the mark of excellent institutions, and SIEPR is one, that when a remarkable person steps down, there's another remarkable person to take their place. And I look forward to Mark Dugan's leadership of this remarkable institution. You know, actual questions about the economy, Steve, are hard enough to answer without answering hypothetical questions. So I'm not going to answer yours. I'm not even going to elegantly evade it. I'm just going to say I'm not going to answer it.
Okay, can I just say that?
No, you can't. but I will tell you this. I think that our speaker tonight, Ben Bernanke, did a remarkable job in his 8 years as Federal Reserve Chairman. But probably the dumbest thing he said in 8 years, and there has to be something, no matter who you are, was when he said subprime isn't really very big, and the housing market is big, and subprime isn't that big, and the capital market is vast, so no matter what happens with subprime, it's really not going to be an important systemic event for the U.S. economy. That comment doesn't look so good in retrospect. Nor does the decision that, well, after Bear Stearns, everybody knew that it was possible that an institution would fail, so it would be okay if we allowed Lehman to fail. That does not look like such a wise judgment either. And I think those who think that markets have had a long time to get ready for Greece, that Greece is relatively small, that there is a large capital market, and so if Greece goes, it won't have systemic consequences. They might be right. There's a real chance they're right. I might even be a better than 50-50 chance they're right. But I think it is folly not to suppose that letting Greece go is a very risky act that has potential systemic consequences. You know, if you have a family and you have a child and the child is really a million miles out of line in 100 respects, and it's a big family, and you disown just one child, just one of the children you disown, and the child was really different and the child really badly misbehaved, it's very hard for the rest of the family not to get nervous and for the rest of the family ever to be the same again. And so I think we are looking at a more consequential situation with respect to Greece than many suppose. And those who absorb bad news about Greece and pour into Portuguese, Spanish, Italian bonds that now have one handles, they might be right. As the late Rudy Dornbusch used to say, things take longer to happen than you think they will, and then they happen faster than you thought they could.
I thought that was Simon and Garfunkel.
And so I don't minimize. So I think that the situation in Europe bears very close attention, and it might be de-risked, but a huge amount of financial error takes the form of supposing that dangerous situations have been de-risked simply because we've had quite a while to think about them. And I would not want to leap to that conclusion.
And at the summit 7 years from now, we'll have that quote probably, and we'll be able to revisit that. Just a quick housekeeping thing. If you have a seat at your table, could you raise your hand for the people in the back and the sides who are being forced to stand when there are actually seats at the tables. Thank you. I want to, as the moderator, in all good humor, I want to make the observation that one economist asserted that God had said something and three economists ducked it. Okay, so I want that to be out there. Okay. So, and I get your point on counterfactual hypotheticals. Bob Rubin was recently quoted as saying that the over-reliance on monetary policy is leading to the potential danger that politicians are being allowed to be unaccountable or reduced accountability by politicians. Would one or both of you like to comment on that?
Wendler.
I think everything Bob Rubin says is wise. And that particular comment had a wonderfully Delphic quality. And so if you thought we should have more fiscal stimulus, then you could agree with it. If you thought we needed to reduce the deficit, then you could agree with it. If you thought we needed more structural reform, then you could agree with it. Almost whatever you were for, you could say, I wish people were paying more attention to my thing and maybe the fact that central banks are as active as they are. Is contributing to their not paying attention to my thing. I think life is about choices. Would I prefer that we lived in a world where economies were healthy and interest rates were in a more conventional place and the size of the central bank balance sheets in the industrialized world were at a more traditional level? Yes, I would absolutely prefer that. Given the situation in which we find ourselves, do I believe that Japan would have a healthier economy if Mr. Kuroda had been less aggressive? No. I believe that if Mr. Kuroda had been less aggressive and everything else had been the same, in all likelihood, Japan would still be deflating at a more rapid rate, its debt problem would look more serious, and its economic growth rate would be lower. Do I believe that if Mario Draghi had followed the advice of his German constituents and renounced the idea of engaging in QE, that somehow there would have been some dynamic in which they'd be doing lots more structural reform in Greece, or Italy would somehow be turning into a capitalist paradise? No. Do I believe that there'd be more deflation? Yes. Do I believe that that deflation would build into an adverse cycle? Yes, I do. And similarly, you can debate the precise path that the United States followed with respect to QE, but do I think that somehow if long-term interest rates had been systematically higher over the last 5 years, that the American economy would be stronger right now? No, I think if interest rates had been systematically higher, there would have been less investment, lower asset prices, and the American economy would have been less healthy. You know, there's a kind of thinking which in its extreme form takes the form of suggesting that smoking in bed is really a bad problem, and if we just abolished the fire department, people would be more responsible about not smoking in bed. And that argument has a certain logic to it, but it's more, I think, a perverse logic than a convincing logic. And so I regret that the situation is not better, and I regret that a variety of other policy levers have not been used more wisely. But do I think that a general mode of central bank retreat would have led the economies of the industrialized world to be better, I think that's a very, very difficult argument to make. And I would say further in that regard that I think there's a certain, I have a somewhat different perspective than a lot of other people do on in thinking about the role of central banks. My good friend John Taylor, who's been enormously influential over time in the central banking world, believes that the most, and I'm probably putting words that aren't quite fair in his mouth, but seems to suggest that the most important thing for a central bank to do is to be predictable. And I guess my reaction is that the most important thing for a central bank to do is to react to what's happening in the world so as to stabilize things. And if you can't predict what's going to happen in the world, then you really shouldn't be able to predict what the central bank is going to do. So I think that the idea that the central bank is saying in the United States right now that it is data dependent and will look at a range of indicators to judge where the inflation risks are and will react appropriately seems much more appropriate than to have some set of pre-committed policies as to what will happen to interest rates, or even some set of pre-committed policies that are contingent on one or two of the many, many indicators available.
John?
Well, let me say this in probably in many ways same things in different words. It strikes me that it is not so surprising that banks, central banks, have reacted the way they have, given the evolution of economic developments and especially price level, in the sense that an institution that is charged with controlling prices doesn't, I think, ever want to be in the position of saying, there's really nothing I can do here. So action is going to be forthcoming in those circumstances. It strikes me that there's very little illusion at this point that additional quantitative easing is having a material impact on the economic outlook and outcomes.
In the United States?
In the United States.
You don't
States.
Mean that in Europe and Japan? You don't mean that in Europe, do you?
I'm not so sure it's quite so consequential in Europe. And certainly it has been disappointing, I would say, relative to conventional, to earlier expectations in Japan. So what I'm coming to say is, I think we're at the end of any kind of illusions that central bank policy alone is going to be determinant, and that we're going to inevitably be turning increasingly to other, let's call it fiscal and structural policies.
On the this is on the global economy, so let's go to...
Can I just say that,
sure.
that I'd agree very much with the last comment John made, which I think is very much right, which is that it is also easy to overstate the impact of central bank policies, and particularly quantitative easing policies, in a world where you have a very large and reasonably well-functioning capital market. After all, if you think about it, how far can 10-year government bond yields really get from a reasonable expectation of where the next 43-month T-bill yields will be? And, you know, the way I've used it to state the extreme case is there's a relatively stable relationship historically between $10 bills and retail spending. Imagine a central bank embarked on a massive operation to print a large number of $20 bills and buy back a large number of $10 bills, would they have any meaningful impact on the economy? And that kind of logic, when you start getting to financial instruments that are very good substitutes for each other, raises a question about just how efficacious quantitative easing will be.
Nonetheless, of course, central banks will have the challenge in the coming years of reestablishing some kind of sense of how are they getting back to a more sustainable policy, since their own description is that these policies are temporary and to deal with a specific problem.
I think we're headed, I think there's something, John Cochrane has written very powerful, very, I think, interestingly on this. I don't tend to agree with some of John's policy prescriptions, but I think he's been very, very thoughtful in basically describing how we're moving into a new world of central banking, where traditional monetarism is becoming kind of irrelevant. We all pay for things electronically. Basically, what's going to happen is the central bank's going to say there's a rate at which they're prepared to borrow and they're prepared to lend. And if they're prepared to borrow and to lend at that rate, that's going to be the rate. And you're basically going to get policy set by statements as to what the interest rate is going to be, rather than through the use of quantity instruments. And I think in that world, it's going to make much less of a difference whether the central bank balance sheet is big or small than would have come out of conventional kind of monetarist analysis. And I think you can even make reasonable arguments that a larger supply of larger central bank balance sheets means more safe short-term instruments for banks to hold, and that may well contribute to the liquidity and the stability of financial intermediaries. So I, at least, though I've given the matter quite a bit of thought, have not been able to relate well to the concern that a large central bank balance sheet is per se an indicator of either inflation problems or financial stability problems to come.
Yeah, that does lead me into, let me take that one step further. So far, and I don't know if you wanted to come back to this later on and talk about financial system and regulatory reform, et cetera, but it strikes me that heretofore, to a large extent, the reform efforts in the financial sector have been backward-looking and inspired by the idea of we can't let that happen. Look at those bad things, and we've got to make sure they can't happen again. And less in terms of what do we want the financial system to look like in the future? How are we going to make it move there, and how are we going to structure our control mechanisms, our public policy mechanisms, consistent with that? And so this is going to be, I think, a challenge for years to come. As Larry implied, there's going to be a lot of structural changes in the financial system brought about by all kinds of things, including technology, that we have to think about. What do we want to have happen? How are we going to make it happen? How are we going to ensure safety and stability?
Well, let's pretend like I asked that question, which is down here.
I didn't want to presume, Steve. I didn't want to presume.
And then, Larry, you can follow on his answer.
Look, I think the most important thing that's happened that, in my judgment, is likely to contribute to increased financial stability in the future is that we have been through a period that was terrifying. And people don't have that long memories, but they have memories that last some time. And so I think if you look at the industrialized world as a whole, am I more worried about complacency and excessive lending, or am I more worried about fear and insufficient lending? Right now, I'm still more worried about fear and insufficient lending. If I look at what's happened to credit availability for U.S. households with average kinds of credit ratings in terms of their ability to get a mortgage, it has been interfered with much more than it probably should have been at substantial cost to the economy. If you look at middle market businesses in Europe, if you look at the contraction of banking systems that's led to a serious curtailment of trade finance with emerging markets. I am, on a global basis, more worried about too little lending, too little confidence, than I am about too much lending and too much confidence. Now, that will not, and you know, and if you look and you study, you know, it's quite remarkable the way there was basically a pretty continuous 20-year bull market from the end of the Second World War to the beginning of the Vietnam War. And what that really probably was about was the gradual lifting of fears of another Great Depression. But it took a very long time for it to happen. So I think that for the near term, that which people discuss less is actually probably more important than the precise dynamics of the implementation of this Dodd-Frank rule and that Dodd-Frank rule. I think that if you study financial crises and people in this room who've made a deeper study than I, you will not find a financial crisis in which leverage did not play a central role. You will not find a financial crisis in which some kind of positive feedback mechanism with more leverage, more asset price appreciation, more leverage, more asset price appreciation, followed by depreciation, followed by deleveraging and devaluation of assets wasn't an absolutely central element. And so what do you do about that? One view, which I would reject, is that what you really need to have is a set of really thoughtful analysts and regulators in the government who will discern when there's emerging bubbles and will use something called macroprudential regulation to prick the bubbles. I don't think anybody's smart enough to do that. There are very few people who have made money twice in a massive macro short based on identifying a bubble. It's the essence of a bubble that the conventional wisdom is wrong, and it's the essence of democratic government that it distills and acts on conventional wisdom. And so I think the macroprudential approach to identifying and replacing bubbles is chimerical. I think the better approach is to make the system safer for the cycles of greed and fear that are inevitable as long as markets are populated by human beings. And that's an agenda that is heavily about larger capital ratios, greater liquidity requirements. The internet bubble was roughly as big in terms of how many extra trillion dollars there were of asset price inflation as the housing bubble. But depending on how you count, it probably did 10% as much damage. And that's related to the fact that the holders were strong hands who were not heavily levered rather than weak hands who were heavily levered. So I think the agenda of greater liquidity and capital requirements that we've had has been is a broadly appropriate agenda. I am concerned that what we call capital when we regulate may bear only a modest relationship to actual stability. The fact that the SEC issued a report explaining that Bear had a capital ratio somewhere in the mid-teens the day it failed seems to me to speak to the quality of the capital ratio concept they were using. Wachovia was deemed similarly to have a double-digit capital ratio as it was failing. And one can say the same thing about a set of other institutions in 2008. So I'd like to see more role for the analysis of market prices in the measurement of capital and liquidity. But I think it's taking the capital and liquidity down that is probably, in my view, most central to having a system that is safer.
Larry just said is important, raises a few issues. One, you referenced the immediate post, a couple decades past World War II and the progress that was made then. I think it's important to think back as to the basics. The basics were an institutional, global institutional framework was put in place in the economic and financial sphere with two elemental goals. One, a progressive and substantial reduction of trade barriers, and second, an increasing guarantee of the fluidity of international financial flows and a guarantee of liquidity to avoid the kind of collapse that led to the Great Depression. One of the worrisome aspects of the current environment is it has now been 20 years since we've had multilateral trade liberalization. And we're to a period for the first time since the onset of the crisis, since World War II, that global trade is growing at a slower pace than global GDP. And I happen to, it's circumstantial evidence, but I think there's a case for a relationship. We need a new efforts in that regard. Secondly, it was obviously true that part of the issue was a capital issue of financial firms, that they were undercapitalized. Wasn't the only aspect, in the sense, I'm sure Larry remembers the so-called senior supervisor's report on risk management in major financial institutions that was published in 2009. It was a retrospective on what happened, in which the supervisors concluded that for the majority of systemically important financial institutions, risk management systems were inadequate to manage the risks that they were running. The question to me was, I thought of is, if this was evident after the crisis, hadn't anyone noticed before the crisis, and why hadn't something been done about it? But the other aspect is, it strikes me that there's a risk that the regulatory reforms that have been put in place are insufficiently coordinated internationally, have had the effect of creating, increasing national barriers to financial flows, which is the opposite, I think, of what we need. We need a coherent international system that will provide safety and stability rather than one that ensures stability by ring-fencing and walling off international markets.
You know, it's hard to be against being coherent.
I was going to go there if you didn't.
I'm glad to hear you're on that side.
I'm given to leaning into the wind, but it's sort of hard to be in some absolute sense against being coordinated, and it's hard to be against economic integration and trade between nations. I looked at the same statistics you have about trade rising less relative to GDP. It's kind of a complicated thing. I mean, here's a fact. If you look according to the Consumer Price Index in the United States at the relative price of a television set and a day in a hospital room, they've changed by a factor of 100. 100 since 1983. Well, since television sets are tradable and days in the hospital rooms are only barely tradable, it sort of figures that when that happens, the share of the goods that are traded is going to go down. If you look at the share of the Philadelphia area, metropolitan statistical area that's tradable, it's not growing as rapidly as it used to either. And that's not because there's a lot of new trade barriers being set up within the United States. I think there is room to work on the reduction in trade, but, you know, hello, folks, the internet, the multinational corporation, the chain, the fact that you can produce things with robots instead of people, these kinds of forces are more important for understanding patterns of global trade than the trade agreements that bureaucrats like you and I were go and negotiate. The capital markets question is a pretty tricky one. First of all, to say that more capital mobility was good coming from the autarkic world after the Second World War, which it surely was, is not to say that from all starting points, more liquidity and more short-term capital flow is always good. And I think there's been a question about that in a number of countries. And, you know, you have to decide which is your poison. It's all very well to say we shouldn't have a balkanized system and we shouldn't have respect each other's rules and we shouldn't segment. It's a great thing to say. But what exactly would you recommend the United States do when a foreign bank that represents, that has assets that are, say, equal to the GDP where the country is hosted, is regulated in a weak and ineffective way and doesn't have satisfactory risk management systems and has very limited liquidity and capital? Would you say that the right thing for the United States to do is to say, well, in the spirit of international cooperation and harmony, we're going to respect the regulation of our foreign friends? Or is the right thing to recognize that that government can't credibly stand behind that bank, that that bank is inadequately regulated, and to regulate to protect the American taxpayer and financial stability in the United States? I think you have a very substantial risk that if you overdo the process of mutual respect and mutual cooperation, that what you induce is a substantial race to the bottom as people try to attract institutions. So I share the concern, but I think it's easier to be against fragmentation in capital markets than it is to live with the consequences of elevating its prevention to being an overriding objective.
For sure. John, can I give you a choice, John? Can I let you the choice to let me change the direction of the conversation or to give a short answer to that and then let me change the direction of the conversation?
Very short answer. I wouldn't want to say there were straw men here, but it's not just, first of all, in the capital markets, it's not just about short-term liquidity, but broader things. And the innovation of creating the Financial Stability Board was exactly the idea, not of whatever you do is fine with me, but let's work out some standards that are acceptable and coherent globally. There was an initiative to do that. I don't think it's really succeeded in the way that had been hoped. And then secondly, in terms of trade, number one, certainly in the Asian region, there's been a huge growth in intra-regional trade involved in economic growth. And certainly the things like TTIP are exactly to coordinate standards that currently stand in the way of trade. I think there's ground to make progress.
You gave me the segue I was looking for.
Oh,
15 minutes ago, I was going to ask you about China. We're talking about coming back here 7 years from now. We're talking about global economy. 7 years from now, you can make an argument that the largest economy in the world will be China. What are your views, John, and then Larry, on China, its development, where it's going, how that affects the world economy?
The fascinating, obviously fascinating, very important topic. It's such a huge place, and there's so many things that you could say. Let me try to do it in the briefest terms. With regard to economic and financial policy, if you look at the 12th five-year plan, it lays out an extremely comprehensive and thorough set of economic reform measures that have the goal of making market forces dominant, that would create an economy with a modern financial system, with a floating currency, with open capital markets, with state enterprises de minimis and private enterprise dominant. Extremely encouraging, I think, from any point of view. Obviously, the issue is, can they get it done, and under what, and what, at what speed, and with what, overcoming what risks? And of course, it's sobering to look at the 11th five-year plan and to see that many of the proposals of the 12th five-year plan were also in the 11th five-year plan, and they haven't happened yet. So, can they get it done is a very open question that with lots of complications.
I've come with reluctance, and maybe it comes from having spent a certain amount of time out of government as well as in government, to think that it's a mistake to overly identify economic outcomes with economic policies. It is true that people who eat well and exercise live longer than people who don't. It is also true that there are plenty of people who have the best habits in the world and are unlucky and are struck by something at a young age, and that there are a certain number of people with lousy habits who nonetheless celebrate their 95th birthday. And I think that's very important to remember in economic forecasting and in thinking about economic outcomes. I published a paper not long ago with Lant Pritchett that made a, basically emphasized it in a variety of ways, a very simple point, which is that if you think it's kind of the basic characteristics of countries that determine their growth rates, you would expect that countries that grew fast in the 80s would grow fast in the 90s, and vice versa. And you'd expect, and this is the way most of us forecast extrapolatively. We think that whoever's been growing fast for a decade will grow rapidly for the next decade. The correlation between growth in one decade and growth in the next decade, if you look across 100 or 150 countries, is very low. It's not zero, but it's in the range of 0.2 or point, in the range of 0.2 or 0.3. So extrapolative forecasting is a very perilous thing. And I think that is the beginning of wisdom with respect to China. The question perhaps should not be, will China keep it going as it always does, or will some problem stop China? Will China, which has now beaten the odds several decades in a row, do it again? I think if you put it that way, you are led to be less optimistic. I think that I don't disagree with anything John said about the path of Chinese economic policy. I do note that if you look at growth in various credit aggregates relative to GDP, which is usually a harbinger of trouble ahead, whether in the United States in the middle of the decade of the noughts, whether in Asia before 1997, whether in Japan before 1989, China is today relative to some distribution of countries 1.5 to 2 sigmas, maybe more, to the experiencing a rapid debt buildup. I think China has a very, very profound problem balancing what are two central objectives for their government, at least as I judge the matter. One central objective for their government, perhaps the central objective, is to maintain the control of the Communist Party and to manage economic policy, foreign policy, everything so as to maintain the control of the Communist Party. Now, that control rests in part on totalitarian stuff, suppressing dissent, blocking off the internet, and all that. But probably to a larger extent, it rests on what I would call Tammany Hall stuff, broadly defined. The selective dispensation of favors. You're more likely to get a promotion if you're constructive from the party's point of view. Your kid's more likely to get into college. Life's just better if you're being party compatible than if you're not. On the one hand, that selective dispensation of favors is central to the model. On the other hand, they are, for the sake of legitimacy, embarked on a huge anti-corruption campaign. Well, the line between the selective dispensation of favors and corruption is a very narrow and thin one, and that is a very difficult balance to strike. My prediction would be that the odds are two-thirds that there will be some kind of substantial discontinuity that will interfere with Chinese economic growth over the next 7 or 8 years. And relative to the consensus, I would be pessimistic about China's ability to keep it going going forward. Now, that said, I probably would have said the same thing 7 or 8 years ago. And today I'd be saying, well, there's a two-thirds, well, I only said there was a two-thirds chance, so I wasn't wrong. So I don't want to overstate the degree of confidence that I would have, but it seems to me that they've got very large challenges and that it is by no means assured that if they do a reasonably effective and sensible job of implementing the Bretton Woods consensus that John described, it would be a serious mistake to suppose that there was, that one could be highly confident that if they just did that, all would be well and they'd enjoy 6% growth for another 15 exactly. years.
John?
But the relationship with the rest of the world would be, economically and financially, would be different depending on the model they pursue. So it seems to me it's a very important question 10 years from now if they still have the current structure of their economy or the one they claim they're trying to implement.
Yeah, I think that's right, although from the point of view of the rest of the world, what was in some ways the central indignity that was being, indignity is not the right word, the central insult that was being inflicted on the rest of the world, which was a quasi-mercantilist massive export surge into finite markets in a demand-short world. That has been, insofar as that is the problem, their current account deficit as a share of GDP is probably 35% of what it was at the peak 6 years ago. The argument that their currency is substantially undervalued is not a credible argument today, and indeed they're intervening to prevent it from devaluing. So in terms of the sort of bad citizen in the world thing, I think that there has been a non-trivial amount of progress. Now, if you're a business trying to produce in China and maintain ownership of your intellectual property, you would not be experiencing the environment as satisfactory right now. And so I don't mean to suggest that all is well, but I think we do need to be fair, John, in recognizing that there has been rather more adjustment over the last 5 or 6 years than a lot of people have perhaps, than a lot of people would have expected 5 or 6 years ago.
If you take nothing away from this SIEPR summit, know that forecasting by extrapolation will always be wrong, and probabilistic forecasts will never be wrong. So we've also established that if I go through my list of questions here, we will all have to change our plane reservations for tomorrow. because there's no way we're going to be able to get to all the global questions that I had. So I have a very, very short question, then we'll go to the audience. Short question, which I think you both agree on, which is almost a yes or no, is the United States refusing to fund the IMF. And where are you? And I know where you are on that, but if you want to comment on that.
Well,
John?
If I get the, it's for those who don't know, the G20 leaders in their meeting in Seoul in 2010 agreed to revise the voting share and quota system of the IMF to adjust, I think the easiest way to say it, the top 10 voting shares would under this, would the U.S. would still, it would be the largest, and would still have a veto power over, let's call it constitutional issues. The top 10 countries would be the G7, less Canada, plus the BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China. I don't think that you could make a substitution from that top 10 and come up with a more representative alignment. That, therefore, it strikes me that approval of that reform gives legitimacy to the international institutions. That reform was supposed to be delivered, and the leaders pledged to deliver by October 2012. The only member that has not delivered is the United States, because Congress has refused to approve. The net result, I think, has been the negative impact of that in the rest of the world for the United States has been wildly underestimated. And I think it is not a complete accident that you find things like the BRICS bank being proposed, the Asian Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank being proposed, and actually being formed. We are reducing the coherence, of the international institutions, diminishing the role of the United States, and I don't quite understand why this has persisted.
John's right. It's an easy choice that we should do this. It's a symptom of what's a deeper problem, and is, I think, a serious problem in the United States. And I would put it this way. Effective international policy is bipartisan. That's true in the economic area. And here's our problem. We have two political parties, and in one of them, there's no majority or even close for any trade agreement. And in the other one, there's no majority or even close for funding any international organization. And if you can't have international organizations and you can't have trade policy with bipartisan support, then you don't have much in the way of international economic policy. And if you're the largest and most powerful and leading economy in the world and you can't have much international economic policy, that's not very good for how the global system is going to function. And my plea to people on both sides would be we just have to take the hubris down a little. I would say to my Democratic friends, you don't like the exact trade agreements that we can negotiate with respect to the rest of the world. Well, we are one country in the rest of the world, and we can't make it exactly to our liking. And I would say to my Republican friends, who even some who are very internationalist, tend to oppose funding the IMF or the World Bank, that you're probably right that, at least in part, that these institutions have a variety of problems, do things are wrong, can be sources of moral hazard. But it doesn't work if the United States can't be part of supporting the system. And I would say more generally that, these issues implicate these questions of funding international organizations implicate the same issue that was implicated, in my view, in a very problematic way by the Cotton and 48 Republicans letter to the government of Iran. I'm not here, I don't hold any brief for the putative agreement that may be reached. I don't know whether it's a good idea or not, but I think it's pretty hard if the United for the United States to move forward in the world if we're not able to have a president of the United States who appears to others like he's able to negotiate and whose word in some way is binding of the United States. And towards that end, I'm for all kinds of consultation with the Congress, but I think we do need to find a way where the United States can make agreements, whether it's to fund the IMF, or it's with respect to nuclear proliferation, or any of another wide range of issues.
Right, and this, and sadly, wide range of issues. These are two case studies of a large number of case studies where our current government is not working effectively. But let's go to the audience for questions. All three of us view that as the most important part. Do we have questions? There's a question back there, the first one I see.
Thank you. Marco Nunziata with General Electric. I have a question for Professor Summers. Discussing the challenge of central banks potentially having to unwind their balance sheets, you mentioned earlier a very interesting point, which is partly because of financial innovation, interest rates are going to be the anchor and central bank balance sheets might be less relevant. However, you also argue that quantitative easing and therefore the size of balance sheets are important in Europe today, and certainly they were important until yesterday in the US. So my question is, how confident are we that the size of central bank balance sheets becomes less relevant before it becomes more of a problem?
I'm pretty confident, you know, look, all statements made with certainty are mistakes.
Okay.
It's our third lesson.
My uncle Ken Arrow just inquired whether I was sure that all statements, think about that for a minute, that all statements made with certainty were errors. I think the way to conceptualize this a little bit is that what really matters is what a government, which includes a treasury and a central bank, as it conducts its financial affairs, what claims it asks the rest of the world to hold, claims in terms of money and claims in terms of bonds. And the question of what claims are held by the Treasury versus what claims are held by the central bank versus what claims are held by the Social Security Trust Fund, those are a kind of purely internal accounting. From the point of view of American Express, it really is a matter of very little relevance if I loan money to my wife or my wife loans money to me. And there is that character to central bank balance sheet claims. So in a world where interest rates can be set, I don't see why the size of central bank balance sheets should, and where interest is paid on reserves, why the size of central bank balance sheets should be particularly correlated with any kind of economic outcome. And I'm not aware of any evidence that historically it has been when interest is being paid on reserves, as is the current regime, currently contemplated regime in the United States.
John?
I'll use this as an opportunity, since the question was about the ECB. I think a clarification about the ECB's own view of the impact of QE. People remember back to May 2012 when Mario Draghi, speaking in London, said, "We'll do whatever it takes," and the rest of the phrase was, "And believe me, it will be enough." Last August at Jackson Hole, he gave a speech that I think could be paraphrased as saying, "We'll do whatever we can, and believe me, it won't be enough."
Secretary Schultz has a question.
I'd like to make an observation about China and have you comment about it. Beginning about 30 years ago, fertility in China dropped like a stone. So for a quarter of a century, they had a rising labor force and a declining number of people the labor force had to support. The rising labor force was added onto by increases in value added and productivity by virtue of movement of people from rural to urban areas. Probably the cream has been skimmed off that process. At the same time now, those who represented the rising labor force are retiring. And the labor force now is consisting of what came from the low fertility. So as I see it, China is almost inevitably going to have a rough period ahead because the demography is compelling. They'll have very low rises, if any, in the labor force. Productivity will not be rising very much. They have severe pollution problems to cope with. And the people who have moved from rural to urban areas have moved from the traditional Chinese cocoon of being taken care of by the family and the community into more anonymous settings, and they have to devise a security system of some kind which doesn't now exist. So all these things add up to me that China has a rough time ahead. Would you comment?
Well, before I turn it over to you, I have a question. If you look at this, we talk about the millennials in the United States, and this afternoon we have a session on millennials. The millennials in China are without siblings and about to support multiples of their existence in their society. Does anybody know, is anybody here or one of you know, how many millennials there are in China? It's got to be several hundred million. Anybody know? I don't know. Okay. Now you can answer this question.
George, I would... Of the various factors you cited, there's going to be slow labor force growth, like roughly none, compared to 1 or 1.5. And other things equal, that'll take 1 or 1.5% off the GDP growth rate. Seems all but assured. There's going to be a substantially higher dependency rate, and that's going to because there's going to be a higher fraction of the population that is aged, and that's going to require important reallocations of resources. That seems arithmetically assured. The question of what economists that you referred to that in the economics literature is called the Lewis turning point. That a big part of economic growth success in developing countries is that you move people from being unproductive in rural areas to being productive in cities. And so you're, in addition to the stuff we get in the United States, you get the gain from their being five times as productive in the city as they were in the rural area. My understanding, having discussed that with people in China, is that there's kind of a raging debate as to whether we hit the point where there wasn't much more of that rural to urban gain now, or whether it's going to be hit in 10 years. After all, there still are 700 million people in rural areas in China, and how many of them can feasibly move is a matter of debate. And so the timing on that one is in debate, but that it's ultimately going to come, I think, is certain. And there's no question that they have very large environmental problems. And some of the recent research on what they are doing to the IQ of Chinese children is really very, very disturbing in its implications. So I think those are further reasons for concern about the rapidity of China's growth going forward. And I think that there's a phenomenon that psychologists have documented, that almost everybody falls victim to, which they refer to as excessive subjective certainty. People tend to underestimate the range of outcomes that are possible. And I think there are very few people, even pessimists, who would have predicted 4 years ago, when B was the first letter in BRIC, that Brazil would be as bad as it is today. And even people who were pessimistic would not have guessed it would be as bad as it has managed to get. And I think that a very wide range of outcomes in China has to be recognized as a possibility.
Quick comments. Demographic shifts are like glaciers. They move very slowly, so that at any given moment in time, other things seem more important. But when we look back, we can see they were immensely powerful. And I'm sure that's going to be the case in China. And that's why I think that is the primary motivating force for their economic reform efforts and their recognition that they need to improve their economic efficiency, and they need to do it substantially, and they need to do it soon. Whether they can get that done, to my mind, is really a critical question on where they're going to be 5 or 10 years down the road.
Hard to imagine there's zero questions. I have five. Okay, there you go.
Go for it.
Yeah. I'm very interested in your views on the role of technology in improving the economic or quality of life values, because it seems to me that technology has had a big influence on many of these trends.
Sure. Thanks. I'll do this very quickly. Thank you for that question. I was hoping something like that would come up. Productivity. Everybody remembers the old Groucho Marx line, who are you going to believe, me or your lion eyes? I think in the case of productivity, I suspect it's sort of the other way around. Namely, the statisticians tell you that productivity has slowed way down and not much is going on. And your lion eyes tell you, how can that be the case? I know there's some smart folks who can think of very clever reasons why undoubtedly all these things, all this technological change that is transforming our daily lives really hasn't had any impact on productivity. But I tend to suspect we're not measuring it very well. And I'm way more optimistic about the medium-term outlook for productivity growth here and elsewhere.
And for its impact on income growth and on standards of living.
Exactly.
Right. Larry?
I suspect that whether it's mismeasurement or whether you're trying to measure the wrong concept,
That'll do.
Facebook's a fantastic thing. It makes a lot of people happy, and it doesn't show up in the GDP accounts to any appreciable extent. The automobile made its first appearance in the U.S. GDP accounts in 1935. And I suspect people will look back at this moment and see things that are comparable. I think, though, that there's a very, very profound question about what it's going to mean for most people's lives and how they work. And I've had a sort of change of heart in some ways on what I think is something that's at the center of this issue. When I was an MIT undergraduate in the early 70s, we were at the tail end of a period where there'd been much discussion of the idea that automation was going to displace work and that it was going to be a real problem because how were people going to earn incomes because the machines were going to do things instead of the people. And basically what I got taught as an MIT undergraduate, I mean, it was taught a little more politely and with a little more nuance, but the essence of it was that Bob Solo had shown that that was stupid. And the essence of it was that those were a bunch of Luddite, goofy people. And that, of course, if people were more productive, then there'd be more income. And if there was more income, the income would get spent. And the income would get spent, and it would put people to work. And it would really all be fine. And this was just a bunch of goofy stuff that sociologists said. That was basically what I got taught. That's basically what I thought. And what I would have thought for most of the last 25 years 25 years, 30 years after that. It has occurred to me, however, that when I was being taught that, 19 out of 20 men between the ages of 25 and 54 in the United States were working at the average moment, and that today, only 17 out of 20 men between the ages of 25 and 54 were working, and that right now, if you're a 45-year-old man in the United States, you are more likely to be on disability insurance than you are to be working in production and manufacturing. And there are a set of substantial changes that are underway. And, you know, it's, the analogy is wrong, but it illuminates the economic logic of the situation. The sort of harsh economic logic is illuminated by asking yourself about horses. Horses have all the capacities that they did in 1900. Horses are just as productive as they were in 1900. But our economy is not able to support nearly as many working horses as it was in 1900 because of what has happened with technological progress. Now, if that can happen as a logical possibility to horses, the prospect that there are certain categories of labor, which may not all be the most unskilled categories of labor, for which similar kinds of substitution will take place. I mean, everybody says, isn't capitalism wonderful? We had this agricultural revolution, and we used to all be in rural areas, and now most of us are in cities, and it all has worked so splendidly. Well, at some ultimate level, it has worked splendidly, although I would note that every industrialized country in the world is spending a significant fraction of its income still supporting agriculture 100 years after that transition. And I would further note that the process of going from rural to urban societies led to a transformation in the role of government, ushered in by Gladstone and Bismarck and two Roosevelts and Wilson in the United States. And that if you think about the current transformation, think about the size of agriculture relative, which was losing people because they were becoming so much more productive, relative to the rest of the economy, industry, services, all of that. Now think about the size of the sector where displacement is taking place, whether it's manufacturing, whether it's services, relative to the set of places where the displaced have to go. And I think over the next generation, perhaps the next two generations, we are looking at something very, very profound that has incredible possibilities for emancipation and the removal of people who are doing jobs that are tedious, dangerous, and unsatisfying, but that will also come with some very profound social challenges.
John, two remarks. One, Larry, I hope the AFL-CIO wasn't listening. But, but secondly, I also think you got it right as a student, but it turns out the story is way more complicated than we might have thought back then.
Rarely does a moderator get this opportunity. Okay, everybody's realizing that lunch is coming, and the post-lunch speaker gets to ask the last question of the pre-lunch discussants. So, Romanio, you're on.
All right, so Larry, you and Pritchett have written this very interesting paper, and it's humbling in a way. But there seems to be one thing in these cycles, long cycles, that is there, and it has to do with debt and credit. And they're slower than the business cycle. They go for a long time, but we see them. And then if you overlay the demographics, I think you have the ingredients for possibly asking some interesting questions. And in the spirit of what George asked the two of you vis-a-vis China, I wonder if you could comment on how you see these future variables evolving in the mature economies, in Japan, in Europe, and in the U.S. And I think of that also having as a backdrop politics, as you did discussing China, because you have these social democracies that make a lot of promises, but that perhaps given the demographics and the debt cycle may not be, delivered. Thank you.
An excellent question. It was directed your way, Larry.
Armenia, I'd say three things. First, as you know, the demography is really quite discouraging for the industrialized world. I'll get to Armenia's proposal to short bonds. the demography, the labor force in Japan is already shrinking. In much of Europe, the labor force is shrinking. And in the United States, over the next 25 years, unless we change our immigration policy, it'll grow at 2 or 3/10 of a percent a year. If we don't have problems from shrinking participation, which we probably will. So that's going to be a break. It may or may not be a break on per capita GDP growth, but it surely will be a growth. The days of 3.5% as normal U.S. GDP growth are essentially certain to be over. One of the many things that I think we need to think hard about as a society is how we handle an aging population. I've had the experience more than once of speaking to a CEO of a financial company who, with great CEO-like confidence and hubris—confidence, I won't say hubris—but you can tell that I'm thinking it. Announced that it was just obvious we needed to raise the Social Security retirement age to 70 so we could control entitlements so that the budget would be healthy, and that it was just obvious, and he couldn't understand how we did it. And I would respond, I'd say, tell me, here at your bank, how many people are there who are working who are over 65? Oh, well, not very many, because, we need to have a modern young labor force, and we've really been very successful in cutting costs. And I said, well, has it occurred to you that if everybody takes your approach, it's going to be a bit of a problem to raise the Social Security retirement age to 70? Oh, well, yeah, they ought to just do something. So I think by the way, for people who are enthusiasts of this, if you look at life expectancy at age 55 in the United States, if you are above the median income, it's gone up by about 5 years since the 1970s. If you are below the median income, it has gone up by about 1 year since the 1970s. And so one needs to be careful about saying that everybody's retirement age should go up. So I think the demography is going to surely slow things down. I think in the United States, we are working our way through the various debt imbalances associated with the financial crisis and have worked our way a significant part of the way through them. I think that's less clear in Europe and Japan. I think that we do something in the United States that we don't give ourselves enough credit for, and that from which the rest of the world could learn, which is that every year the Congressional Budget Office publishes a 10-year budget outlook, and it also publishes some kind of 75-year long-term budget outlook. And they don't have a publication like that, to my knowledge, in any other industrialized country. And that has a substantial impact in reducing the responsibility of their policies. And one should not confuse transparency about America's entitlement problem and non-transparency about the entitlement problem of others with the United States having a more serious entitlement problem. if you could measure it right, the entitlement problem would be much worse in Western Europe than it is in Japan. Where I would not be quite where, I suspect you are, is in the United States for sure, and I suspect for Europe and Japan, though I'm less sure. If you study carefully the entitlement problem, you will decide that it is three times as much a problem of healthcare costs rising faster than income as it is a problem of a larger fraction of the population being over 65. And we have had very good news for the last 5 or 6 years in the United States on healthcare costs. And if that good news holds, and you know, holds could mean that we don't have catch up for our slow growth, or holds could mean that growth continues to be slow, which would be even better, then our entitlement problem will be much, much less serious than has conventionally been supposed. What will happen to the growth rate of healthcare costs going forward? If the field of health economics had a completely convincing explanation for why it had slowed, it would be more convincing in its views about what will happen going forward. So I think the right view is a lot of agnosticism. But I think it's a mistake to say that because we've got a budget deficit and because we've got bad demography, we are fated to have much higher problems in the future than we've had the past. And I guess I would say that there are also some factors that I've talked about when I've talked about secular stagnation that are leading to structurally lower interest rates than we've had historically, including the fact that it used to be that if you were a $20 billion company, you'd have to have tens of thousands of people and factories and stuff like that. And now there are any number of $20 billion companies that could fit all their employees, all their capital, and all their stuff in the right half of this room. And a kind of demassification of the economy, combined with a variety of factors like rising inequality that are increasing savings, suggests to me that normal levels of real interest rates may be substantially lower over the next generation than they have been over the last. And if you combine a generalized deflationary tendency with low levels of real interest rates, I would be cautious about that bond short and would remind you of what you know well, which is that people have said in Japan that 1% or 1.5% or whatever the number is really, there's really not much room between, there's a lot of room between that and normal, and there's not that much room between that and zero. Therefore, it has to be a good trade to short Japanese bonds, and that's been a kind of 25-year disaster to the point where it's known as the widowmaker. And I would just be cautious about taking that view with respect to the United States.
John, you get a quick response. We're done.
Well, it's a great question that raised some very important long-term issues. One thing I learned here as a graduate student that up until World War II, I think this is still right, up until World War II or thereabouts in the industrial countries, that the the percentage of your lifetime that you spent post-employment after working tended to be more or less stable. So essentially you're working, as your life expectancy went up, your working life went up. It was the institution of the Social Security systems or pensions, government-sponsored pension systems that caused the deviation in the recent period. And now life expectancy has gone up. It's an interesting question to see. I think it's easy to ask a broad question. Are people going to want to spend a lot of their lives, a big percentage of their lives, post-employment? I don't know the answer. I sort of suspect not so much. That brings me to another question in the context of what you mentioned, Larry, is how many people are going to be working for banks with fixed retirement ages in the future? Or is the labor market going to look a lot different than it does today? And I think you hinted at that when you're saying we're not going to have these big, massive corporations necessarily. I think the market could be much more fluid. And you mentioned the other, you missed this morning, I think, a very fascinating presentation by Elizabeth Holmes here, interviewed by George Shultz about Theranos and the potential for some really substantial implied changes in the very structure of the provision of what we consider of healthcare and emphasis on preventive medicine, and start thinking in those things. I guess that's why it's so much fun to come out here and think about these things. It strikes me that there's a lot of reason for expecting some big change, as you suggested, that maybe bigger changes than we even tend to think of. It strikes me a lot of reason for optimism, and probably a lot of reason for taking Armenio's position on bonds.
Yeah, well, anyway, there is a great temptation to get other people to pay more taxes and to get them to work longer. Okay,
it's always a good solution.
In any case, we need to be back here at 12:28, and you are now on lunch break, out back or in the lobby. And thank you very much, Larry and John.
You're great. Thanks so much for doing it.